The following presentation was recorded in front of a live audience at the River Center in St. Paul, Minnesota.
Please help me welcome Dayna Steele. Dayna?
You know, the fire marshal's having an absolute conniption right now. That was great. I love that. I took my stepson to a concert a couple of years ago, and I was like, what are they holding up? And he looked at me and he went, cell phones. And I went, really? What happened to the lighters? He goes, what would you need a lighter for? Okay, never mind. Cell phones. I'm going with that one. Thank you so much for having me out here today. Thanks to all of you guys from coming in from all over the country for this great event. I'm going to tell you a little bit about myself. As long as I can remember, I wanted to be a rock star. I was going to be wildly successful at something. There were a few things holding me back, though. Can't sing, can't dance, can't play a musical instrument. Okay, I was going to let that hold me back. I was going to find something. So when it finally was time for me to go off to college, I said, you know what? I'm going to be a doctor. How hard can that be? That sounds like rock star. What do? I'm a doctor. So I went off to the family alma mater. For those of you not from Texas, find someone who is from Texas and they will explain that later on. I am just very proud to say that no matter where I speak in this world, there is always a whoop for Texas A&M. Again, it's a long story. I heard one down here. Went off to A&M, managed to change my major and my living arrangements every semester so my parents could figure out exactly what kind of rock star I was going to be. Then I went to a party in Bryan. Now, Bryan is like the bigger city next door to College Station. And a DJ from Bryan came to a college party. Now, let's face it, when a DJ from Bryan comes to a college party in College Station, that was like the biggest star I'd ever met. And I wanted to go out with this guy. And he was making fun of the new student radio station, daring people to audition. So I did. I thought, well, if I audition for the radio station, he'll ask me out. He never asked me out, but for the next 22 years, I was on the radio. And by the way, that's the part where I used to say, and I don't have any idea what happened to Jeff Lowe. I'm here to tell you that if you're 82 years old, I don't care. Your old boyfriend will find you on Facebook. Hey, I hear you were talking about me at a speech today. Ah! Sure enough, it was him. But the minute I sat down and put on those headphones, I knew I was home. I knew I had found my passion. I would work 24/7. I would sweep floors. I think they gave me a full-time job at the radio station just so I would go away every once in a while. I would file records. For those of you under 30, they're about this big. Here. I'll show you a picture. That's what they look like. Every once in a while, they skip. That's kind of like your iPod losing power. But that was a record. I would do anything it took to be at the radio station. And for the next 22 years, it's what I did. And I had a great ride. And I had the opportunity to be around some of the biggest rock stars of all time. Mick Jagger, the Rolling Stones, Van Halen, Sammy Hagar, ZZ Top, Def Leppard. And I really started to watch these bands. And I noticed they all had something in common. And since that time, through my entire career, radio, television, business, I've noticed that the rock stars in any business share these four rock star principles. The first one is passion. You've got to follow your passion. Let's face it, you're not going to always sell a concert ticket. The record you record is not going to always be a hit. You gotta follow that passion. But what makes successful people successful is they also follow the passions of others. I knew my fans loved rock and roll. They loved rock bands. They loved rock stars. They loved rock stories. I'm from Houston, Texas. We love our hometown. I could talk about Houston, Texas. All right, Houston. It's a lot cooler and less humid here, though. Yay, St. Paul. So I followed the passions, and that's what you guys do. You don't sell trips. You don't book plane tickets. You sell passion. I love rock and roll. I love speaking. And I love to travel. I just got back from England and Scotland and Paris. And I took my kids last year to Italy. That's my passion. And that's what you guys are dealing with every day, is passion. And a good thing about passion is going to get you through things. Let's face it, economy, not been the greatest thing in the world for anything, including travel. But you're dealing in passion. You guys are passionate about what you do. And it's going to get you through all of this. One of my record people gave me this book a long time ago. There must be a pony, and because you have a few more sessions and a trade show this afternoon, I'll give you the short version. Two brothers walk up to the barn. They open the doors. It's filled to the rafter with poo. I'm cleaning this up for you, so to speak. The first brother looks at it and says, "There's nothing but poo in there." And the second brother looks at it, and he grabs a shovel, and he starts to dig, and he says, "There must be a pony." That's what passion does. I firmly believe that there is a pony on the other side of the poo in everything I do. Passion's also going to get you through things you never could have imagined. In 1984, the drummer for Def Leppard, one of the biggest rock bands of all time, still are. They were huge in the 80s. The drummer on New Year's Eve 1984 decided to race his Corvette through the English countryside. He did. He wrecked it. He was thrown from the wreckage, and he severed his left arm. That is not the way he is standing, second from the right. He's the drummer in one of the biggest rock bands in the world, and he only has one arm. Just a couple of months after this happened, he was inviting drummers from around the world to join him in rehab and help him figure out a way to play his drums with two good feet and one good arm. One of the highest grossing acts this summer, 2009, Def Leppard. That is what passion does. The second rock star principle, knowledge. You can never stop learning. That's what you guys are doing here today. You're gathering all this information. I don't care if you're Warren Buffett. You never stop learning. Gene Simmons, one of the biggest rock stars of all time with the biggest tongue, was asked in New York City a while back, what's the one thing you attribute your success to? And without hesitation, Gene Simmons, the rock god, the rock demon of Kiss, said, "I read. I read everything I get my hands on." And I used to tell people, I didn't play Stairway to Heaven or Freebird any different than any other rock star in the world. What I did do was read. And I could talk about anything, anytime. I could talk about what was going on in Houston. It gave me the opportunity to recognize things I could be involved in. And I challenge every one of you today, the next time you are by a magazine rack, for those of you flying out later, go into the airport newsstand. Buy a magazine that you know nothing about or that you don't even like the subject and read it from front to back. I promise you, you will think of things in a new way. You will get something from that magazine. For me, it would be NASCAR. I'm sorry, I don't get it. But by God, these are the best branding people I have ever read about in my entire life. I got something from the magazine. Do your homework. That's a part of knowledge. Any customer you work with, try to find out a little bit about them. Do you realize you can Google every single person in this room? And you can probably find out something about them on the internet. That's kind of scary, isn't it? But you can Google people. It's okay to Google yourself, I promise. Google yourself, Google your clients, do your homework. People always ask me to this day, who was your favorite? Hands down, Sammy Hagar, best teeth in rock and roll. I mean, they're blinding you in the back of the room, aren't they? But Sammy always did his homework. Sammy could be on the radio for 2 hours and never bore me or my audience. And let's face it, the audience, the listeners, those were my customers. And if they weren't happy, what did they do? They tuned out. So it better be a rock star who could talk about something interesting and more than just schlepping his new CD or his show. Sammy would pick up newspapers when he came to a town. He would read the newspapers. He would do his research. He would talk to his manager. He would talk to his record company. He came into that radio station, and you felt like Sammy really liked you and knew you because he had done his homework. Another important part of knowledge is keeping up with your finances. And if you haven't learned that in this economy, you have to. I know this is not a financial conference, but I like to bring this up because it's so important, even more so now than ever before. And if Mick Jagger can do it, you guys can do it. Everybody here been to a concert? You got your ticket, your $300 ticket to the Rolling Stones. It's how much? Wait a minute, they used to pay me to come introduce them. So you walk into the building and the anticipation's building and the, you know, the roadies are on stage and, you know, they're tuning up the guitars and check, one, two, check, check, and then to everybody, you can just feel the buzz in the air and the lights come down and the pyro goes off and the band starts playing. About that time is when the tour accountant and the tour promoter go into a locked room and settle the show, and somebody walks out with a nice suitcase, usually full of hundreds of thousands of dollars. Everybody, that is, except the Rolling Stones. Mick Jagger settles the show before he goes on stage. And if you knew you had just made over $1 million for an hour and 44 minutes work, you would walk like this too, back and forth across the stage. But if Mick Jagger has time to watch his pennies, so do you. The third rock star principle, networking. Somebody once said to me, "You will never get a date, Dana, sitting at home on the couch alone." You're right. You have to get out. Relationships are everything. Whether they're personal or business, relationships are everything. We called it schmoozing back then. I didn't realize I was networking at the time. But that's what you guys are doing here. How many of you are sitting at a table right now with people you know? That's pretty good. That's pretty good. If you are with a table full of people and you know everybody there, I want you to promise me that before this day is over, you are going to go introduce yourself to some people you don't know. Form some new relationships. Meet some new people. Who would you rather do business with? A complete stranger or somebody you know or somebody that you know recommended? Get out there and form those relationships. And when you do, listen. John Mellencamp used to walk out of interviews, not because he was a prima donna, but because if he felt like the DJ wasn't listening, it was wasting his time. Listen to what people say. When you ask somebody a question, listen to the answer. Listen to what they're really saying. In a group like this, or out in the hallway, or in the ladies' room, by the way, the line's much shorter in the back, ladies. Just be quiet for a minute and listen. Some people would call that eavesdropping. Just listen. You'd be amazed how much you pick up on when you're in a networking situation and you listen. Also, networking is doing things for others without asking for anything in return. You guys remind me of doctors. What do doctors get asked at parties? Free advice. How many of you get asked for free travel advice all the time? Well, give it. Give it every chance you get. Because eventually, you know what you become? The neighborhood expert. Oh, you're going to Hawaii. Well, you know what? My neighbor helped me with some information. You should call her. She's a travel agent. My neighbor helped me with a trip to Scotland. You know, you should call him. He knows a lot about Scotland. Or any of these destinations, or you know, your daughter's getting married? Oh, have you thought about a destination wedding? I know somebody who does that. She helped a friend of mine once before. Help, help, help. Give all the advice you can without ever expecting anything in return, and I promise it will come to you. David Crosby of Crosby, Stills & Nash was a guest of the great state of Texas for 8 months and 4 days. When he got out of prison, he was in a halfway house in Houston. His manager called and said he needs a dentist, he needs a doctor, blah, blah, blah. Nobody will help me unless I give him an exclusive interview. I can't give you an interview, but can you help me? Well, sure I can help you. First of all, it's the right thing to do. And it was my hometown. I knew everybody. Hooked him up. Long story short, David and I became really good friends. First time Crosby, Stills, and Nash came through Houston to play the Woodlands on June 3rd, 1990. The first time David had performed sober was that tour. They came through, David invited a bunch of the astronauts. Astronauts are engineers. It's like herding cats. They can get to the space station, but the will call window totally escapes them. So David's like, there's a bunch of astronauts coming, can you help me coordinate? I help him coordinate it. One of the astronauts brought a pilot with her who really loves Crosby, Stills, and Nash. His name is Charlie Justice. My name is Mrs. Charlie Justice. You never know. Of course, I text David every once in a while, hate the teenager sending him to live with you. David texts back, no, have one same age, don't you dare. And another part of networking is letting people know what it is you want, what it is you need. For the most part, people love a happy ending. That's human nature. We all love a fairy tale. We all love to see people succeed. But I can't read your mind. I don't know what you want. I don't know what you need. I'm not your mother. It's the only person that can read your mind. Let people know what it is you want and need. I created a website a few years ago called Operation National Anthem, just strictly because I don't understand why people can't take off their hat and put down their cell phone and put their beer aside for 60 seconds and pay attention to our national anthem. Why not? So I got a group of soldiers in Iraq to record public service announcements for me. Hi, my name is, I'm stationed in. Would you please remove your hat, stand up, and pay attention to our national anthem? It would mean a lot to me over here. It was something that I just felt compelled to do. I didn't do it for personal gain. I didn't do it for money. I created the website so that anybody, large or small, you know, the organization can go to the website, download the video, use it before Little League, Rotary, the Vikings, whatever. Anybody can use it. NASCAR even called me. Sure. And why do y'all drive around and around? Okay, never mind. Sure, you can use it. I sent an email to friends and family and said, if you know anybody that would like to use these, send it out. That was it. Forgot about it. I just felt like I needed to do something. I got a call 9 months later from Reader's Digest. We'd like to do a little blurb on Operation National Anthem. I said, great, how'd you find out about it? She said, you sent an email out, and my brother got it. I didn't know John's sister worked for Reader's Digest. She said, he sent it to me. I've been holding on to it for 9 months. We might do something. Not only did they do something, they called it the best patriotic pitch, and they put me on the cover of Reader's Digest, which was very humbling, next to the late, great Randy Pausch, which, by the way, if you have not watched the last lecture on YouTube, take 1 hour and 16 minutes of your life and watch it. It will change it. And this is just for the ladies in the room. If the men could just close their ears for a minute. I was kind of hoping they could move Harrison Ford over about two places so that just once in my life I could say, why, yes, I was under Harrison Ford. The fourth rock star principle is appreciation. You don't get anywhere in this life without help from somebody else. I don't care who you are, what you do, how successful you are, nobody, zero, zilch, nada, nobody gets through this life without help. And you have to continue to say thank you and show appreciation. Bands do it with platinum albums and gold albums, and I don't know what they send now, but I get platinum iPods. I still have to explain to my son's friends, what is that gold thing on the wall? Never mind, just not even going to attempt to tell you what it is. But they do that, and they fly DJs all over the country to see their shows. The Rolling Stones don't have to say thank you to anybody anymore. No matter what the Rolling Stones that put out, it's going to be a hit. But what do the Rolling Stones do? They have a big press conference. They bring in the record people and their management and the people that help them. They bring in some of the top DJs from around the country. As big as they are, they know they still have to take care of the people that take care of them. I learned about appreciation from Billy Idol, a face only a mother could love. Actually, Charlie the Wonder Husband can do that with his lips. That's probably why I married him, but that would be a whole nother speech. Billy Idol played Southern Star Amphitheater in Houston. Now, Southern Star Amphitheater, they weren't sure this was going to fly. It was at the back of our amusement park, which was a Six Flags amusement park. And what they did originally was they cut a hole in the back fence, they put a gate, they put a stage, a porta potty, and a trailer for the band, and went, amphitheater. You can make people believe anything. Just promote, promote, promote. So Billy plays a show, breaks all attendance records at Six Flags, all attendance records. They are so blown away. Management is so blown away, and I am still blown away to this day by what they did. They turned on all the lights and all the rides next door at Waterworld, the giant water theme park, gave Billy and his entourage of 13 people, which included me, a bathing suit and a towel, and for 2 hours said, have fun. Which to this day, when we walk into a water park, my kids go, duh, we know. more fun with only 13 people. Take my word for it. And I'll never forget the smell of wet hairspray. And the eyeliner running down faces. And that was just on the guys. But no matter how big you are, you have to reward a job well done. The people above you, the people below you, the people beside you, the strangers that help you, you have to say thank you. And you have to give back to the community. Not only do you have to do it because you need to support your community, it is a great way to get the word out. Let's go back to that free advice that everybody asks you for. This is the time of year. School has started. We all get hit up. You know, can you buy cookie dough? Can you buy, excuse my language, crap? Can you buy, how many moms in here are having to sell that stuff right now? Thank you. Can I just write you a check for $150 and will the PTA leave me alone? I'll be happy to do it. But you know, they have all these events and all these charities and all these fundraisers. Why can't you donate a half hour of travel advice? An hour of travel advice. All these silent auctions, every charity does. All of a sudden, there's your logo, there's your name, there's your business cards. Again, you are the expert. So not only are you helping this charity and you're giving back, when I owned the space store, we couldn't afford to buy ads in all these magazines, but we gave to every charity. And we got more customers that way by donating little toys and little items to silent auctions. And it's a great way to give back. By the way, if you don't recognize the people behind me, that is a baby John Bon Jovi and a baby Richie Sambora. And this is the history of my hair. So I hope you're taking notes. All these artists would come in and do our rock and roll auction. Whose records did we play 6 weeks before and 6 weeks after? All of the guys who donated their time and came in to the rock and roll auction. Appreciation is also doing the right thing just because it's the right thing to do. The boy in this picture, Kevin Hinden, was 17 years old, living with cystic fibrosis at a time when CF patients normally didn't make it to 18. I'm very proud to say, as a board member of Cystic Fibrosis in Houston, that CF patients now live to 37. But at the time, it was an anomaly that Kevin was still alive. And I read an article. They interviewed him for when we had more than one newspaper in cities, for the Houston Post. And he kept quoting a rock band. Well, I recognize the lyrics. My mentor, my godfather, managed Van Halen. This kid was quoting Van Halen. And they were coming to town. So we arranged, we had it all set up. He was coming to the show as Van Halen's guest. The band paid for an ambulance, an oxygen, and medical personnel, because this is when you could still smoke in the building. So they wanted to make sure. By the way, the building is now Joel Osteen's church. It's Lakewood Church. And I did send him a copy of my book, and I inscribed it, "Dear Joel, most of these stories happen in your church." I got a form letter back. Oh, well. But Kevin got really sick 2 days before the event. The band, it was about probably 1985, Van Halen was the biggest band on the road. They were at the top of the charts. They should have been doing a sound check. Instead, they went to Texas Children's Hospital and spent 2 hours with Kevin. Eddie bought him a guitar. They gave him guitar lessons. They hung out with him. 2 weeks after this picture was taken, Kevin passed away. I found out Sammy Hagar had been calling him every day, and he had also been negotiating with the hospital to replace, it's hard to see it, but there's teddy bear wallpaper. Sammy was like, dude. So from that point on in my radio career, if I had 4 minutes left to play a song, who do you think got played? Van Halen or Sammy Hagar? You do things because it's just the right thing to do. There wasn't MTV, there weren't cell phones, there weren't cameras, there weren't, you know, it was just for Kevin. By the way, I'll never forget walking into the hospital. It was the band, their manager, me, and a couple of bodyguards. So, you know, it looked like Abbey Road. Everybody's walking in, and this nurse goes, "Hey! You somebody?" Sammy Hagar stopped. I swear to God, it looked like a cartoon. It was just like, bam, 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 bam. Everybody ran into each other. Sammy went over to her. He grabbed her. He scooped her in his arms. I thought he was going to drop her. Yeah. He dipped her, and I mean tongue and all. He laid the biggest kiss on this woman, and he stood her up, and he said, "Yes, ma'am, I am, and you are too. Don't you ever forget it." The last time I saw that woman, I was getting on an elevator, and she was going, "You do things because it's the right thing to do." You can call it karma, you can call it whatever you want, but that is what I have seen in successful people. They do those kind of things without expecting anything in return. And last but not least, every single one of you has one of the most powerful tools, the ability to make the most powerful impression. It's called a handwritten thank you note to the people that work with you. I don't care if you have 1,000 clients. You start writing handwritten thank you notes, and I promise you, you will see your business increase. It is a lost art. It makes people remember you. It makes people feel special that you took the time to get a stamp, an envelope, a piece of paper, and a pen, and say thank you. Don't worry about your handwriting. Just write a handwritten note. And if you're going to do it, don't make it a pissy note. Because somebody might put it in their book and use it in a speech 29 years later. Sean Cassidy was the Hannah Montana of the late 70s. And just like Hannah Montana and Miley Cyrus, he was trying to break out of that whole pop thing and be taken seriously as a rock artist. And they brought him to town. We were both, 20 years old, 20, 21 years old. I can have a conversation with a chair. I get along with a rock. Sean Cassidy and I hated each other's guts through the entire dinner. I don't know what it was. I guess, we were 20 and our egos were bigger than this building. And a couple of days later, I got this note. Think of it this way. If you play the record, we won't have to see each other again. Things could be worse. Okay, anybody like to guess how many times I played Sean Cassidy's record? We all walk onto the same stage. The minute you get up, every single one of us, the minute you get up and you put your feet on the ground, you are stepping on a stage. And you got to decide how you're going to perform on that stage and what equipment and what band members and what roadies and what are you going to do. But before that, you have got to check your foundation, the corners of your stage for success. Passion, knowledge, networking, and appreciation. Once you have that strong stage, you can do anything. Before I leave today, I do want to leave you with some of my favorite inspirational quotes. Believe in yourself. Life is too short to have anything but delusional notions about yourself. I'm not offended by dumb blonde jokes because I know I'm not dumb and I definitely know I'm not blonde. Ignore the naysayers. I have not failed. I have just found 10,000 ways not to make a light bulb. There's no such thing as failure. And this one's especially for you because you guys deal in adventure every single day. Life is either a daring adventure or nothing. This is from a woman who was deaf and blind, Helen Keller. Have fun in what you do because that's what you're dealing in, is fun and passion. And you're all doing an amazing job with it. I'll tell you the rest of the story. I became a rock star, at least in my own mind. And the best part about the job is I get to hang out with rock stars like you. Look around. Rock stars like you each and every day. Give yourselves a hand. Thank you guys. I know you've got sessions coming up. For those of you who are on Twitter and Facebook, keep in touch. Have a great afternoon, and remember, Ken was right. You guys do rock. Thank you.